Perfect. Good. Okay, great. So for those of you who are new, the format is 1 hour. Feel free to just interrupt with questions as normal. You're probably muted right now, which is a good way to be while the talk is happening. Just unmute yourself and ask a question. We also have co-authors in the chat room. So if you have a smaller question, something you don't want to bring to the whole, you don't think you want to interrupt the whole talk, you can post it to the chat room, and then the co-authors can respond there as well. Okay, so you have an hour. Go ahead.
Well, please, let me first start by thanking the organizers. This is co-author work with Esther, Ruth, and team. Because of their affiliation with the Federal Reserve Board, the usual disclaimer applies. They're here, luckily, to answer questions. Let me turn this off because it was giving me a little bit of noise. What we want to do in this paper is we want to look at the U.S. Confidential TIC data to present several stylized facts. And we want to argue that a lot of the growth in dollar flows in related to inflows and outflows to the U.S. Are intermediated in tax havens and financial center, and the nature of these flows is risky. Let me start by some motivating figures. I am showing here the flows to and from the US to Cayman Island. Here you can see the growth in both total claims and total liabilities. So the intermediation through Cayman Islands has increased, particular after quantitative easing and Dodd-Frank, a mixture of increase, if you want, global assets, and also some arbitration or arbitrage in macroprudential policy taxes. The figure also shows that most of these flows are related to non-bank financial system, mutual funds, and so forth. And most of these claims are in dollars. Just to give you some numbers, the increase in equities has been close to 700%. The increase in liabilities close to 400, corporates around 100. Treasuries, they don't hold a lot of treasuries, but that also has grown close to 600%. And what
Laura?
Yes?
Earlier we had the paper by Brent Nyman and the other authors, I don't remember, but can you kind of connect the issues here to that? Because it seems like there's some connection in the
Yeah, I'm going to mention in a little while, I'm going to relate to the literature. Let me start by saying that we're not the first ones to document this. In fact, this has been documented by Lena Melesi Ferretti in one of the most important contributions to the literature. People have also used the TIC data. Let me start by saying that we're using the US data, which we argue is the best data in terms of quality and also scope. And I'll explain in detail why. I guess a difference is that we're claiming that these are risky assets, if you want to sum what is the main difference. We want to claim that this intermediation through tax havens is intermediating risky assets, as opposed to this view that all this growth in U.S. Activities are related to safe assets. Hello? I want to say again that Cayman Islands is the main one in terms of growth, but the facts that we're going to document are more general than just Cayman Island. In general, this has been a trend in these tax havens and financial centers. Again, Cayman Islands overwhelms because of the growth. And again, a lot of this growth is related to the non-bank financial centers, but also most of the US treasuries, which we argue would be the safe assets are held by the official sector. And so again, what we want to do in this paper is we're going to use this, the US confidential data. This is a unique granular data set. It reports both what US residents hold and all the foreign and what foreigners hold of US securities. It's very comprehensive and it's very carefully done. And I'll want to explain many of the issues. One needs to be careful when using this data, which is not clear to me. Everyone goes into this much care in cleaning the data. We're going to present some macro facts related to the global financial cycle, or if you want in this case, the dollar cycle. We're gonna also try to find patterns in terms of the role of corporate taxes and prudential regulation. But if anything, the conclusion from this macro analysis is that one needs to go a little bit deeper. There is so much one can understand the motivations of investors and some of these trends by just looking at the macro variables. And that is why we exploit the granularity of the data. Right now, we're just exploring sectorial measures of risk, sharp ratios, and real risk uncertainty, which from now on, I'm going to call GSZ to avoid mispronunciations. And I'll explain in detail some of the how we match this data and also how one needs to be careful when approaching this type of data sets. And we are going to rationalize our results through a model that features endogenous entry in tax havens and also endogenous risk taking. Just to give you a preview of some of the findings at the macro level, we're gonna run the traditional global financial cycle regressions. We're going to control for the growth of the VIX, dollar exchange rate, Fed's fund rate, and again, the traditional variables. We're gonna find that the official sector, most of the official sector, the holdings of equities and corporates does not seem to be responsive to these variables. If anything, we find that treasuries tend to respond to exchange rate related variables. I have some previous work that has documented that indeed a lot of the safe assets are being held by a official sector for exchange rate management purposes, and our findings seem to be consistent with these motivations. In terms of the private sector, what we tend to find is, again, some evidence that they do respond to measures, different measures of risk and uncertainty. What is interesting is that the tax havens and the non-tax havens, these variables seem to behave in similar ways, since we know from the data that there has been an explosion in flows to tax havens. That motivated us to try to dig deeper and exploit and look into more micro motives. And so what we do is first look at the role of corporate taxes and prudential regulation. And I'm going to explain in detail, again, some of these measures are proxy variables with many challenges in picking up the actual corporate taxes. But even with the limitations, we do seem to find evidence that flows tend to be going to places that are in general less regulated. And so exploiting some mixture of tax or regulation arbitrage. And also we find evidence that these private holdings, or this is consistent with an idea of these private holdings being risky. And so what we do is we match our data, again, using different identifiers, to these measures of risk and uncertainty. And we tend to find some evidence that, in particular, liabilities tend to be riskier. I'm going to explain why in a little while. At this moment, we're mostly focusing on liabilities. It has to also do with some of the way one matches the data for the official sector. Again, just to show some big picture findings, dividing our data between between tax havens and non-tax havens, we do in general find an increase of risk and measure as total risk or also as average risk. But we seem to find, again, these increases mostly in tax haven, although, again, it depends how you measure many of the risk and the different securities. In general, we seem to find this difference in favor of tax haven and some increase related to quantitative easing and Dodd-Frank. And we also push a little bit more in trying to understand some of the motivations. That data does suggest that there has been a growth of intangible firms, of firms in the intangible sector going to these tax havens. Our conjecture is that in general, these are associated with relatively lower cost of moving. There's also regulation that makes intangible not being collateral for banking purposes. So a mixture of these two would lead for firms and funds, mostly in biotech and also technology and so forth, again, the intangible sector, to try to exploit this regulation arbitrage. And so we run some industry level regressions and we do find evidence that in particular the intangible sector is exploiting some of these arbitrage. So again, we seem to find that there seems to be this potential to exploit the arbitrage. These tend to be riskier. Again, the growth mostly after this mixture of quantitative easing and Dodd-Frank, and in sectors that tend to move easily. And also mostly the private sector, treasuries seem to be motivated by different variables. And so we finish the paper with a model that tries to rationalize these differences. And so we think of a general equilibrium model where firms, and here you wanna think of firms perhaps as conglomerates that produce in different parts of the world, but fund themselves also in different places. So they fund themselves by some global intermediary. They're going to be heterogeneous in their default probabilities. They're going to choose where to fund or shift profits, paying a fixed cost. If they go to the tax havens, they're going to be able to enjoy this tax benefit. And again, we think of it broadly as some tax arbitrage or regulation arbitrage. Now, and they're going to be funded by these global intermediaries. The global intermediaries are themselves going to fund in the global capital markets. They're going to have access to the global liquid market. And they're going to fund the firms in some spread that solves some incentivable compatible contract when they're trying to endogenously decide how much to monitor each one of these firms. And in our model, we're going to find that a fall in the cost of debt, an increase in global liquidity, leads to more firms being profitable, more firms choosing to become, to shift profits to tax havens. This is also associated with a more risky firms. If you want, we call this a risk selection effect. And so we're going to have that there's going to be more risky firms moving to the tax havens. So already we're going to get an extensive margin of more risk, but also the intermediaries are going to choose to monitor them relatively less. So there's going to be some intensive margin also in terms of risk. Because of the increase in profits, these firms ex ante look more profitable, but expose their riskier. And so we label this, the title of the paper, this elusive safety as firms appear more profitable. And so again, in terms of the literature, this paper relates to very many literatures. My apologies if we're not citing your work. Please send us your paper and we're happy to cite you. a broad literature relates to tax havens. And here there is the work by Jim Hines and co-authors back in the 90s that looked at the incentive of US firms to locate first in Puerto Rico, but also abroad because of different changes in US tax regulation. Jim Hines with me here and Fritz have also looked at the different incentives firms may have in terms of equity and debt, trying to exploit, these differences in tax. Fatih and Kim have also looked at using the BEA data, what are the effects of this arbitrage in terms of productivity. A team with different co-authors has also looked at tax arbitrage, and Emmanuel Sainz and Gabriel Zugman in different work have also explored the role of these tax havens. And again, this literature is old and growing, and again, it has been documented the different incentives to try to locate abroad. If in terms of contribution to this literature, what we're going to do is we're going to introduce a theoretical model that blends, if you want, moral hazard contracts with endogenous monitoring, with Mellit style, if you want, heterogeneity. But in particular, we're going to use the model of Martinez, Mier, and Repullo, and we're going to blend it with a work that Tim has done. And so we're going to get heterogeneous firms in terms of default probabilities. And as I said, this gives you this risk selection effect. More broadly, a lot of the literature in multinationals has focused on organization, industrial organization, if you want, motivations of why a firm may want to locate abroad. And so it differentiates from foreign direct investment. Here, usually the idea is that firms have an special asset or know-how that allows them to compensate some disadvantage that they may have when going abroad. And so, as I said, this literature has been done very independent from the capital flows literature. There's some few work that has tried to combine multinationals and capital flows, mostly exploiting credit frictions. So again, very old work from the 90s, Frood and Stein, looked at the role of information frictions to try to understand patterns of foreign direct investment and capital flows. Michael Klein with co-authors also looked at the particular bank-firm relations in trying to explain flows of FDI. And Paul Antras and co-authors have looked at the role of contracting frictions also in a type of a Holstrom-Tirol setting as ours. If anything, what we bring is more this relation to the risk distribution and the role of endogenous monitoring in these in shaping some of the incentives. And of course, we relate to the literature on tax competition and profit shifting. Here again, there is the work done by Tim, but also Ottaviano and co-authors have looked at this. Here again, we're looking at the emergence of FDI in terms of these exploiting this arbitrage. More generally, we also relate to the literature of tax havens, capital flows, and risky assets. As I said, the changing landscape of global capital flows has been documented for a while. Elena Melesi Ferretti in their different vintages have documented the growth of financial intermediaries. Frank Warner with co-authors also using TIC data have documented these facts. In particular, exploiting the TIC data, Berto and co-authors have shown that there is an increased share of US equity and debt claims in tax havens, and again, intermediated through mutual funds and hedge funds. Tim has also documented the growth of CLOs in tax havens, which are again ways of recycling risk. As was mentioned, the work of Jesse and Majori and with different co-authors, they have also looked at this change towards tax havens, exploiting private data. But if anything, some of their work it tends to stress the fact that a lot of this growth is related to safe assets. we perhaps link more to work that has argued that this relates more to risk-taking. And here the work by Bruno and Sheen and Stefan and Sheen and Philip Lane, again, has documented that risk-taking channel for global banks. Here we're gonna focus on securities. So in the paper, he presents a description of the data, some very general macro facts. Then we go into macro determinants, where we look at the role of global financial and dollar cycle. I just realized that I missed dollar cycle in the sentence. Then we present some micro origins. I wrote here, this is preliminary. Right now we're exploiting sectorial. We're moving into the firm securities, and I'll explain some of the challenges there. And we're gonna present a model of multinationals and risky funding, and then some preliminary conclusions and next steps. Let me broadly define the data. We're using this unique confidential data set on cross-border security holdings from the US. It presents very detailed data in breakdown across countries, type of securities, treasuries, debt, equities, and so on, type of investors, official, private, and also different type of issuers. It also has information on the ultimate destination, equities, multinationals, and so on. The reporting of this data is required by law, so the US requires all residents to report their holdings abroad and everyone buying a US security to report. In fact, in this, the US probably is one of the few countries that has this level of detail. With Esther, we're trying to find out about the Europeans. The Europeans don't have this dual, if you want, requirement for US residents and for foreign residents. This data, as you know, is confidential. So it's a good thing that my co-authors are here. For many reasons, I cannot see this data. This data has to be handled by the folks at the Fed. And I actually understand that it cannot leave one room. But from interactions from Ruth, we know that this data requires a lot of care in making sure there are no measurement errors, and the folks at the Fed do a very painful work of making sure the data is properly clean. So we're gonna argue that this is the most accurate measurement of US cross-border and asset positions. And I would take it a little bit further. If one is not doing and taking care of the data that it's cleaned properly, there might be important issues with other sources. For this work, what we're going to do is that we are going to try to maximize the data as much as we can. Ruth can explain the different service that they have been using with different lengths, depending on the source that we use. It can go to 2 or 3 or 2 or 4 or 4 for claims and liabilities. The recent data is up to 219. A previous version of the paper had data until 218. We're adding 219. So some graphs I'm gonna show you are going to have 219. Let me start with some broad characterization of US claims and liabilities. Perhaps for everyone in the audience, this data is well known. So in terms of US claims, you can see that the US, when they go abroad, they mostly buy a private corporate equity. So the US, when they go abroad, is mostly equity and private. There's very little in terms of other assets, but you can see here the composition. Of course, liabilities dominate. As everyone knows, the US has been running a recurrent current account deficit for close to 40 years. And so you can see here the growth in terms of foreign liabilities. Here you see the distribution of type of securities is more diverse. The U.S. Foreigners, when they come to the U.S., they do buy a lot of private corporate, In fact, some of the debt, the private debt, has been growing and bought by private and also officials, but you do see a lot of officials, what they tend to do is mostly buy US treasuries and the like. Here we present the same data, the growth in claims and the growth in liabilities, but we show you the top 10. And here what becomes evident and clear that Cayman Islands, a very small country, even smaller than Costa Rica, and that's saying a lot, dominates both claims and assets in the US. So you'll see here that this is a two-way flow to Cayman Islands and in general, they have been growing. In terms of claims and liabilities, you do see Great Britain and so on and so forth. But what is interesting is when you start looking at some powerhouses like Germany and even France, they tend to be dominated not only by Cayman Islands, but also by other type of tax havens, in this case, the European tax havens. So you start seeing here countries like Ireland, Switzerland, and Netherlands. And also, if you cut a little bit lower, you start seeing Luxembourg again. So it's not only Cayman. In general, you do see a lot of intermediation through these tax havens. And there is, and again, we don't document this, but there does seem to be that each region has their preferred tax haven. When we look at the holdings, again, Cayman Island is alone in terms of the fact that it's dominated by a lot of these private assets, although there is some official holdings. Again, it's also dominated by what we would say is a non-bank financial sector. Here, perhaps, it stands out in relation to some other of the top countries. When you look at the currency denomination, again, Cayman Island overwhelmingly in dollars. What is also interesting is when one looks at some of these European, if you want, financial centers, again, you do see a domination of US dollars in these countries.
Again, Laura, can I ask again? Kind of related, but now it's kind of coming back to me that the Maggiore Nyman was really about how the US actually invests a lot in Brazil, but it all shows up as Cayman Islands. I think that was kind of the point there, was that the Cayman Islands is just the way in which we're owning something in Brazil or some other country. And I guess that's not your question here, is more about the level in the Cayman Islands as opposed to the extent to which it's sort of hiding a deeper level of investing somewhere else.
So if you want, what used to be done in Florida, like recycling subprime, which is US, is now being done in Cayman. So that world of the risk moved to Cayman Island. So it's, again, the data seems to suggest this two-way flow. Now, one needs to be careful because it is true that the US is dominated by liabilities because of the current account deficit. But it doesn't seem to be only that the US goes there to buy junk. It also, the foreigners come here to Cayman to buy US junk. So again, there is a two way. One also needs to be careful when thinking about where something is issued, double book entry keeping, accounting. If there is a liability, there must be an asset some place. So one needs to be careful where the counterpart is. We're just going to look at the US inflows and outflows, but this has been documented in some other places. You do see this two-way flow through tax havens in different places. We don't want to make an argument on the particular bilateral relations of countries. It's more this broader that it's being intermediated in Cayman, and again, this view that is risky, that is not safe assets. If you look at the next picture, this looks at the official and private holdings of US securities. And what becomes very clear is that this darker, which relates to official, and here in official, we're bunching treasury debt and agency debt. You do see that the foreign overwhelmingly buys treasuries. The official foreign overwhelmingly buys these treasury safe type assets when it's mostly the private sector that tends to buy these corporate and equities. If you go and look now, again, these foreign holdings of US securities, you do see a Japan, a China holding a lot of US treasuries, while Cayman is mostly holding these private type assets. And again, consistent with this idea that it's a two-way flow of risky, you do see that Cayman now is dominated, or the asset-backed security type assets are mostly located in Cayman and the like type of tax havens. So again, if you want this idea that risky assets, which we had in subprime, regulation came and they moved somewhere else, and now if you want, the part is happening in tax havens. So again, these very general trends. And so what we do is we start looking at these macro and micro factors to try to understand what's behind these flows. We run this typical global financial cycle regressions. Here in the different regressions, we're looking at a different type of capital flows in each class, asset class, treasuries, equities, or corporate for US liabilities, and long-term debt and equities for US claims, for investors, different type of investor, foreign official or foreign private for US liability over different periods. In particular, we're gonna do it for a month, or I'm gonna present results for monthly changes. And again, depending on the asset or liabilities, the data can start in mid-2000s. I put here 2018, but I think I'm actually going to present you results that already have 2019. If I'm not correct, Tim or Ruth can correct in the chat. We use the different variables using the literature, the growth rate of the VIX, the change in the excess bond premium, a Fed fund rate, or the shadow rate of the Fed fund rate, measures for unemployment outlook, different measures for the federal related to exchange rate and MB spread, and the US variance of risk. We're gonna take the VIX and VRP as measures of risk and uncertainty broadly defined. I'm gonna show you results for all countries, but we have also done robustness looking at and cutting the data in different ways, tax havens, not tax havens, and also excluding the global financial crisis. And so for liabilities, let me focus on equities and corporates. And again, you do find some evidence that it's related to interest rate. That's perhaps one expects. So let me explain how we're presenting the data. Sorry. So in the first, third, and fifth column, we're showing each variable at a time. In the second, fourth, and sixth, we actually include all variables at a time. And I want to be careful not to overinterpret. We know that all of these variables are highly correlated. So again, one needs to just be careful not to overinterpret. So, but when we add all variables at a time, what seems to be driving some of these flows, apart from the interest rate and some exchange rate considerations, is broad measures of uncertainty and risk when looking at the private flows. But in general, not a lot of these variables tend to survive these regressions. And again, we all know that they tend to be very correlated. Treasuries, again, these seem to be motivated by exchange rate management concerns and claims seem to behave similar to liabilities in the sense that some broad measures of uncertainty and risk seem to drive some of these variables. But again, when looking at these regressions, and I'll go fast precisely, because it does seem that there's some macro motivation, but something else seems to be missing in this analysis. And again, I don't want to overinterpret. We all know that these variables tend to be very correlated. But we try to look at the role of regulation and macroprudential. We use the KPMG database. And again, we all know that corporate taxes, the actual tax that a firm pays is a little bit more complex. There are also state and other taxes that may be paid. As we all know, the corporation that is paying the listed price in terms of taxes should fire the accountant because there are many things that they can do. But still, this database provides some general motivation. We're also using prudential regulation from Ceruti. We also use other measures. The message seems to be the same. And again, even with the concerns one may have with this corporate tax rate data, one does seem to find this interesting relation that countries that tend to have this tax arbitrage does seem to be associated with a risk and also a differential sharp ratios. So again, suggestive of this trying to exploit this difference. In terms of macroprudential, for liabilities, we don't seem to find a lot of a motivation here. Again, there are many things countries are doing in terms of macroprudential. When we look at equity, liabilities, again, similar in terms of, it seems that there's some relation between higher risk and sharp in countries that have these tax arbitrage. Here, what is interesting is we do find some evidence that these macroprudentials may be creating a substitution from debt into equity. As you know, a lot of these macroprudentials are trying to prevent excessive bank debt, excessive loans to housing, so on and so forth. So it seems to be suggestive. Again, in this paper, we don't push that too much. But again, there seems to be this relation between this differential regulation and some trying to take advantage of these differences, and also related to differential in risk and sharp ratios. I also want to be careful because we all know that the Caribbean and a lot of these tax havens have had a very low or zero tax rates for the longest time. So again, it does seem to suggest there must be something else behind these changes. And so we look at risk-taking behavior and we examine the risk profile of these flows. To do this, we're going to match our data at the industry level for now with different measures of variability and search for yield. And as I said, we're also going to look at the role of intangibles. And before I do this, let me just mention some caveats and challenges. One needs to be careful. First of all, of course, the TIC is provided by different vendors and by different institutions, is very carefully reviewed, but one does need to be careful that still the mere volume of securities makes this a challenging task. On this note, I also wonder if the private agents that are taking these data have the incentive or the ability to pay attention to some of these differences. And in fact, Lauren Cohen has a paper that argues one needs to be careful with some of the way some of these, the private agents are treating some of these data. There's the other issue that firms may not neatly fit into one classification. We tend to use just one sector. A lot of these firms might be multi-sector and one needs to be careful about that. But we're still gonna put them in one sector, trying to be mindful of different sector type firms. plus the fact that some may not neatly fit into one. Some funds are also opaque, which make the classification difficult, and others are just simply wrong. They give you the wrong classification. And again, this data, if it's not clean and one looks at the raw data, it's very easy to just overlook many of these details that require attention. We face another challenge, that there was a break in the industry classification. Ruth and team have been very careful in trying to map to be consistent. Anyone who has tried to match into different classifications knows that the mapping is not always super clean. On top of that, there was a change in the classification around 206 that adds some other complications. The other that I want to mention is the role of official securities, liabilities, and assets. We're going to try to get or impute risk and Sharpe ratios. Of course, for the treasuries, this is a little bit more complicated. We so far are a little bit more confident in terms of liability because I think we would all agree that we could normalize the US to have the lower type of, if you want, risk. In particular, we can normalize it to zero. If the US defaults on the debt, we have bigger problems that we need to deal with. For assets, the assets the US buys, I think we can agree also that Germany is low, zero risk, Switzerland, so on, but we need to deal with the fact that the US also buys Brazil, Argentina, so on. And so we're gonna show you different type of risk assessments with and without official securities as we advance in the matching of these official assets. We're going to, as I said, use realized volatility, Sharpe ratios, and also we adjust these measures for outliers. We're going to use a risk measure that corrects for the FAMA factors. In future work, we're going to also add excess bond. We are not going to present these results just yet. And the measures of intangible capital comes from the work of Peters and Taylor. So again, looking at the risk measures on liabilities, we find that, and the red dots are tax havens, that overwhelmingly they tend to be held in tax havens. This is when I exclude treasuries. When I include treasuries, the distribution opens up a little bit. After all, Hong Kong does hold US T-bills as well as Singapore, again, management of exchange rates, and it opens up, but you still get a clustering in terms of tax havens. And we try to add this signal also the size of the market. So again, it does seem to suggest that these risky assets are allocated in tax havens, and they seem to have require higher risk and return. This is just to show for countries, a subset of countries. We do this with and without treasuries. In particular, these are measures with treasuries. Again, because China, Japan, which also dominate in terms of the top 10 holders of assets and liabilities, the risk and Sharpe ratios of the tax havens completely dominate some of these other countries. And again, I show here Cayman Island, Luxembourg, Ireland, which are like the traditional European tax havens. But what we want to argue is that it's broadly, it's not driven by just one of them in general. And again, using different measures of risk, Sharpe ratio, with or without US treasuries, we seem to find this evidence that there was an increase in tax havens and also that it dominates in terms of riskiness. We do some simple regressions, liabilities and claims. Again, we're careful because of the role of official assets, but in general, this generalized favor that tax havens are intermediating some of the risky securities. We as I mentioned, go a little bit deeper and look at the role of intangibles. In particular, there has been a growth in this type of biotech and tech and so on and so forth. And we do find that they, again, tend to dominate the growth is in these tax havens, again, with the red dots being tax havens. We look a little bit if disproportionately we see this growth in terms of the role of, again, tax arbitrage or in general regulation arbitrage. And in general, we do see that private flows, in particular liabilities, tend to exploit these tax differences. And again, we do this, we also use different forms of measuring the private flows. We're not trying, in the paper, we're not going to try to exploit whether this is equity or debt, but in general, we do tend to find some evidence suggestive that they're trying to exploit this difference. So in the last part of the paper, we're going to try to make sense of this fact that tax havens are increasingly intermediating risky finance, if you want. As I said in the paper, we don't want to push whether it's equity or debt. We're just going to bunch it as financing. In particular, the paper is going to be about debt, which in particular in our data does seem to suggest that it's riskier. But again, the paper is not trying to understand the sources of financing. We're going to think of a general equilibrium model of multinationals. Again, you want to think of conglomerates that they can produce and choose to enter the tax havens. In the tax havens in particular, they're just going to get funded. In general, they're funded by global intermediaries. The firms are going to choose whether they're going to enter these tax havens. They're going to shift profits to enjoy this tax benefit. They're going to do so against a cost, and their debt or their activities is risky. In fact, the firms are going to be heterogeneous in default probabilities, and so there's going to be a spread in the interest rate that is going to be the outcome of an incentive compatible contract and endogenous monitoring.
Laura, can I just say one thing?
Yes.
So just to come back to Sam's earlier question about how this compares to Brent's papers and like what's been around before. So, I mean, the big advantage of our data is that we have it at the security level, and of course we can aggregate up to industry level, but we can really then think about the micro risk, like different risk measures and kind of a lot of what's really going on. Because most of these other papers are talking about positions. So like, you know, how much of the flows are going through Brazil, how much is going through a tax haven. But the question is, why is this happening? So I think to really analyze that, you would need to understand the moment you channel the Brazilian firm's flows through tax havens, are these different types of assets, are these different types of borrowing or different types of securities? And I think this is where we really want to go. So we want to understand, you know, if you see some of the assets coming directly from Brazil, others are through tax havens, do they look fundamentally different? Are they like different in their riskiness? Are they different in the types of firms that we see there? And as Laura was saying, this is still work in progress, but this is kind of where we try to go. So we don't just want to talk about the size of positions. We want to talk about the composition of the firms and the kind of riskiness of the underlying assets. And so I think this is where our data is unique, and this is kind of also where the model will fit in when the data is complete. So
I actually would prefer people stop using Brazil as an example. Just let me clarify, Brazil, all the positions in Cayman are actually well known by the government. So, because they're mostly done by government firms, but this is a side comment. So let me go back to the model, and I just realized I have 9 minutes, so my apologies, I may run a little bit. Think of to a large country and a tax haven. For simplicity, we're going to assume that production is just in the large country. Again, you can think of some conglomerate that produces in different places and then gets funded in other places. But for simplicity, we're just going to split in two. in the large country also there are going to be two sectors. We're just going to have an homogeneous good sector that is going to serve as the numerator, is constant, is still a return to scale technology, and zero profits again is going to give us our numerator. And once heterogeneous sector that produces different type of goods. And in these different differentiated goods, they're going to be done under monopolistic competition. The only factor of production, if you want, in this case, is going to be debt. So they're going to borrow and they're going to produce. Firms are going to be heterogeneous in respect to their default risk. And riskier firms are going to pay higher spreads, which will relate to the monitoring intensity. And firms are going to endogenously become a multinational that in their case means opening an affiliate in the tax haven after paying some fixed costs to enjoy some tax saving regulation profit shifting advantage. Given the heterogeneity in default probabilities, only a fraction of them opens an affiliate in tax havens. We're going to have some very simple preferences. Again, this is just to make the solving of the model easier. It's going to be a quasi-linear preference. As I said, there's going to be intermediate inputs. They're going to have some theta productivity that is going to have a distribution, and only the units that have productivity higher than the cost are going to engage in production. And so we're going to aggregate into the total intermediate inputs. And so this is going to give us an interest rate that is going to decreasing on the investment, if you want. So the firms.
Just a quick question. So there's nothing about this as being a country, the tax haven. It's just another type of intermediation technology. It could have been a shadow bank, or it could be the savings and loans. What makes this a country?
What makes it a country is that it's going to have this different tax system. And if you think about it,
shadow banks had a different tax system.
A different regulation, different tax system. Okay. We can get philosophical. That is the what differentiates states, the power to tax, because it's related to being able to convince your citizens. But your question is deeper in the sense that this could have been, as I said, Florida. There, something happened in the U.S. that moved out.
Commercial banks in the 80s, savings and loans in the 90s, shadow banks in the 2000s, tax havens now.
So, exactly. So that is why we're like, we are now worried about tax havens, but because of the different things we have been doing, it moved there. And in fact, if you talk to some fund managers, they will tell you that a lot of the activities were intact in Cayman even before QE, so on and so forth. So a lot of the funds were there. And then you just had the growth in quantitative easing and the search for yield. And this mixture that they were there and all these people desperate to find returns is why we're all intermediating in tax havens. We do see in trade also hubs, trading hubs. So I don't want this to necessarily mean is welfare reducing. There might be many advantages to concentrate into trade hubs or financial hubs, in particular, of course, access to liquidity information, so on and so forth. What we're stressing is that this growth is taking advantage of this arbitrage tax prudential, but is being fueled by these lower interest rates that are making investors try to find where to put the money and the search for yield. But you're completely right that this could be just the recent incarnation of a previous problem that just moved out of the US for many reasons. And so, let me see. So again, this is just the standard solving of these heterogeneous models in terms of we're going to have a constant markup over price. And so the profits are going to be the expected profits, and I'm going to explain them in a second, and minus this cost, and the firm can choose to be in the home country or in the foreign against a tax haven, against a fixed cost. So, as I said, firms are heterogeneous in terms of risk probability. So the return is going to be stochastic with a probability 1 minus R plus M, they're going to have a return R. With probability R minus M is going to be 0. These probabilities or the different returns will depend on the monitoring intensity. If the intermediaries do monitor more, they're going to reduce the default probability, but monitoring has an intermediate, has a cost for the intermediary. Firms are going to be funded by these intermediaries that are going to be risk neutral, and these intermediaries are going to go to foreign investors that supply assets at a return RS, and as I said, there's going to be a cost of a monitoring. And the contract is going to be sold from some incentive compatible constraints. And here, as I said, we're borrowing from Martinez Miera and Repullo in terms of the modeling and the debt contract. So again, the firms, the intermediary is going to choose the interest rate and the monitoring, subject to the monitoring costs. They're going to have their incentive compatible constraints. They're going to have a participation constraint that guarantees that they have a positive profits or equal greater than zero. And also you have to guarantee to the international investors that you will give them at least the safe interest rate. So again, some attempt of trying to graph the model. So you're gonna have these intermediaries that are getting funds from the global investors, and you have to guarantee that you give them the safe interest rate, and they're going to give the funds to the firm conglomerate. And the firm can choose whether to be in the home country or the tax haven, and the default probability is going to depend on this monitoring. And so the solving of this model gives you different cutoffs, the cutoff of the firms that are not going to be subject to monitoring and the ones that are going to be monitoring. Within the group of firms that get monitored, there's going to be some intensity into which firms the intermediary would monitor, and we're assuming again following this Martinez and Puyo paper, some functional form that we think is also reasonable that allows us to solve some of these more easily. Again, the firms are going to choose where to locate, and so we're also going to have a cutoff in terms of the default risk and the type of the firm, whether they're going to choose where, if they're going to stay in the home country or to go to the tax havens, and we're also going to get some cutoff. Let me very quickly go over the case of an increase in global savings. In this case, when there is an increase in global savings, a reduction in the interest rate, we're going to get firms have more profits. These firms are then going to choose to enter the tax. More firms can pay the fixed cost and become a tax haven, but we're also going to get the intermediary to lower the monitoring intensity as they perceive these firms also to be doing better. So this leads you to both an increase in the extensive and the intensive margin of monitoring. In the paper, we present some simulations, again, just some cases of how the relation between the risk-free interest rate and the entry threshold and the monitoring threshold, which will make more or less risky firms. We have an example where we show what happens when interest rates go down. Again, this case that you're gonna get relatively less monitoring and more and riskier firms. We try to use reasonable parameters, but again, this is just meant to be a simulation of the paper. One thing that, again, is consistent with the implications of this model, again, we're talking about securities, this is not bank loans. If you look at securities, there has been this movement to get rid of covenants, which people call the light covenant type bonds. And again, if you see the growth of this reduction in monitoring and thus this lighter type of covenants, it again correlates with quantitative easing and the changes in regulation in the US. In fact, I was reading of some of these covenants and some are particularly complicated in the sense that it does allow firms to use many different things to show up as profits. Again, the whether this is welfare improving or not is more complicated because it may allow some flexibility that in the current crisis actually may be welcome. But for sure, you do see an increase, a reduction in how harsh these covenants have been, consistent with this idea that there has been less monitoring. We want to try to see if we can look at the covenants and see, in particular, if there's some distinction. Although, as I said, most of the bonds now that are being issued are covenant light. And what we want to do also with the data is show the distributions. This is liabilities. It is suggestive of this increase in the average risk. So far, we have done it at the country and sectorial level. We want to exploit the security data. So we're matching this to the ID. I don't want to spend a lot of time in terms of some of the challenges. Actually, we have been happily surprised that some of this matching looks promising beyond some of our concerns. And again, for the top firms, it's very easy to match is some of these unknown type of funds that become a little bit more complicated. Some of this matching has been done for liabilities already very successfully, and we're looking into doing it for the whole set of the data in liabilities and claims. And so these are some of our next steps. And just to conclude, we're exploiting this granular data from the US to try to assess the role of risk and search for yield in explaining the intermediation of funds through tax haven and financial sectors. As I said, treasuries seem to be held with other purposes and dominated by the official sector. We do argue that this mixture of increasing global savings and tax avoiding regulation that has been driving some of these results. And in next steps, we're going to take this to the security level. And let me end here.
Okay, great. So now we'll open the floor up for more questions and kind of general discussion. You can just unmute and jump in, or you can raise your hand if you like.
Am I in charge or someone else in charge of calling people?
You can be in charge, yeah.
So I have here Eton. Yes.
Yeah, go ahead.
Under Caroline's name.
Jonathan, we can't hear you, although you don't appear to be muted. Okay. Okay, well, Jonathan sorts out his technical issue. If other people have a comment or a question, they should feel free, and then we'll circle back to Jonathan when we can hear him.
Sam?
Laura, can you just describe a little more about why the intangibles, other than intangibles would maybe generate more riskiness, but aside from that, what is it about intangibles that make them more likely to be done this way? I mean, just kind of like almost like an example of where that would be more conducive rather than a company with a lot of physical assets.
So there's several reasons, and Esther actually, given her banking background, tends to go into regulation. The first one, when it's intangible, we know it's easier to move. You don't need to move production. You can just locate a headquarter, although it is true that anyone can do that. You can produce in one place and have a headquarter somewhere else. But the intangibles particularly allow you to take advantage of a lot of the taxing loopholes, so on and so forth, related to R&D. And so that also has to do with the way that the US is the corporate tax. But the other reason is that the changes in banking have made intangibles not collateral. Is not a collateral you can put. And so that also creates incentives for these type of firms not to use bank loans, or for banks not to want you, or because then it will come with a higher, with additional complications of what's going to be your collateral, and if you're risky, the bank then needs to have more reserves. So this mixture is the one that has made this type of firm particularly susceptible, if you want. I was going to say vulnerable, but it's not vulnerable. The one that will go there. HBS has a lot of people with funds in Cayman. And as I said, a lot of biotech. It's interesting that is there. Now that we're all following the biotech of our preference, just to see who's going to have the vaccine. I don't know if Esther wants to add a little bit more.
Yeah, I mean, so the main problem is this, and actually the intangible economy is growing a lot. And in fact, the next topic of the G20 meeting is the intangible economy, because we know that all the superstars are basically intangible and they are accounting for a large part of a lot of things. I mean, inequality, productivity, and now we see all the flows. I mean, two things. I mean, the first one is that based on Dodd-Frank Act, none of the intangible can be used as collateral. So there has been a big shrinking of banking sectors in the US because they're not giving loans anymore. So the only way for intangible economies is firms is to fund somewhere else. But yesterday I actually also found an event study analysis, which I think we should use, is that when there are hurricanes in the Virgin Islands or Caymans or in the Caribbean, all the local activity stops, but the activity of financial firms, funds and intangibles there doesn't stop. The reason is that they can be sitting in Silicon Valley. It's just that they just need to have some registrations there. And I mean, same thing for European firms. Now there has been this big scandal of this Weir cards, this big company that had, that they had, in principle, they had affiliates in Abu Dhabi and Philippines, but there was nothing there. It was actually a travel agent. So they're not producing. So it's a different type of economy, but it's becoming very, very important.
We do not have Jonathan back. What just happened? I got a little off track. So I have a question, Laura. So it's, you guys are sort of suggesting, or the data at least suggests, that this stuff was, it seems to have picked up like kind of after the financial crisis, or maybe during the financial crisis as well. In the model, you guys talk about an increase in global savings, but that seemed to start a lot earlier than 2008. I think global savings kind of glut, we think about having started in the late 1990s. Do you want to talk about maybe how you think those things are related, or they're like a dip? What do you think maybe the fundamental drivers are, why we're seeing it during QE and not earlier, or something like that?
Laura, maybe can I pick up this question? Also related partly to the model. So it's true that in the model, the kind of primitive we look at is the decline of the interest rate. But there has to be contemporaneously tax arbitrage or a regulatory arbitrage. You're completely right. So the risk taking that was taking place also before, but as Laura mentioned before, it was taking place in maybe some states of the United States or in some banks in the United States. The key thing is not after the crisis, it's after the Dodd-Frank Act. So the increase in regulation in all of the countries has moved. And contemporaneously, I mean, we said the intangible. The intangible in the model is just the cost of entry. So you could think of, you know, the cost of entry has decreased because you just don't need to open a plant there. But it has to be a joint, in the model, it's a joint difference in taxes and regulation.
Hello?
Jonathan. We'll let Esther,
I'm sorry.
We'll go to you. Yeah, no, we can hear you now. No, Esther, go ahead, finish.
That's it. So there has to be the double coincidence of those things, because otherwise you could do this business, of course, also in the United States. But the problem is that you cannot do it anymore after Dodd-Frank Act. So that's the main issue.
So then is the primitive, should the change in the model be a change in then the regulation or something like that? I'm like trying to figure out what the role of this, of the low interest rate stuff is.
So
this is a small technical. That is outside. Our data starts also in 2003. So there's a data constraint to go earlier. And having said that, I do think it exploded, and the model does have a mechanism, and I'll allow Esther to continue. Sorry about that.
No, so the issue is, I think also George said this before. So it is true that, I mean, Cayman is not a proper country. So the primitive is like, you need to have the difference in taxes for those firms to go there. Now, at the moment, the difference in regulatory arbitrage, what we are saying is, you know, there is a better condition there, because if there was a bank in the United States that would charge higher interest rate, that would be a corner solution. You would simply go to the global funds, because the global funds can operate everywhere. So at the moment, there is not really a difference, because everybody would go there, to say if there is no friction for that to the global intermediary. But the very important thing is that in the model, you wouldn't have risk-taking if you wouldn't have a decrease of an increase of the global liquidity. So, I mean, you could have firms going there, but if there is no increase in global liquidity, there is no risk-taking. Laura said, maybe they were going there even before, but they were safer. So again, you need to have two things at the same time.
Okay. But I guess I take Kim's suggestion as like, can we start the model at a point where there's a lot of liquidity and then change the regulation? And I think, you know,
the change in the regulation would not change risk. It would change, I mean, it would make more firms to enter. That's what the point that we make in the paper. So there is a, if you reduce taxes, you see the threshold of entry going down. So the extensive margin of risk increases, meaning that riskier firms with lower default success probability enter. But for the monitoring intensity to go down, you need to have the increase in the global liquidity. So there are those two dimensions that need to happen at the same time. But certainly, I mean, if you decrease the cost or if you decrease the taxes, more firms end up. And because here the distribution is on the success probability, that basically means you are decreasing the success probability of the firms that are entering. And so a riskier group of firms is entering. That's what is happening.
Jonathan, go ahead.
Okay, sorry, I think I might have just missed too much. I just wanted, but let me quickly ask, because I missed, the model went by fast. I missed what a tax haven is. You pay a fixed cost to go to the tax haven, you pay lower taxes, what happens to, you're monitored less as well? Is that because the monitoring technology is different?
So if you want, I can pick up this as well. The monitoring technology is a regular contract, but the issue is that those funds that are in the tax havens are not subject to a capital requirement. So they are able to offer cost of loans that are lower than, let's say, would a US bank be. So the US bank is simply not in the picture, meaning that the firm that has access to the global funding, there would be a corner solution. It would just go to the global intermediary to get funded.
Right.
Now, the issue is that when there is a global, because what we know is that there is also a lot of investors going there. And this is also mentioned in Zucman and Saez. There is a lot of high net wealth people that are parking their wealth into these global intermediaries. And so what happens is that when there is an increase of the liquidity through the contract, the threshold of monitor firms goes down. So, I mean, riskier firms are not monitored. And also the monitoring intensity, so the intensity of the monitoring of each firm goes down. Simply because everything, so monitoring intensity and threshold of which firms are monitored and which firms are not monitored, they all depend on the risk-free rate. And in the general equilibrium, whenever there is an increase in liquidity, the risk-free rate goes down. If you want, intuitively, there are all those people thirsty for risky assets. And so, there is this plenty of liquidity. And so more firms are funded. I mean, it's a little bit what you had seen before the crisis, like when Ian and Sufi were saying, there was plenty of liquidity. And so more mortgages were given, even to mortgage takers that were not very good. Same thing is happening here. And so it's simply that the platform of firms that is funded increases. And so because the distribution is in terms of default probability, you tend to fund riskier firms. That's the extensive margin.
Thank you.
Okay, good. Anybody else, comments or questions? Okay, so we'll call this the official end. Thank you, everybody. Next week we have, I don't know, I should know this stuff. Next week is
Felipe.
Next week is, Felipe, on the micro macro dynamics of capital flow. So this is a capital flow month, I guess, here on the seminar. Felipe, looking forward to it. Everybody else, thanks for coming. Laura, thank you very much for participating. And I will see you guys next week.
Thanks for the invitation.
Thanks.
Thanks a lot for the invitation.
Thank you, everyone.